Tonight on Access TV, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with Joe List, DC Benny, James Davis, Harris Stanton, and your host, Jay Mohr. Gotham Comedy Live, all happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Jay Mohr!
Yes! Thank you, everybody. Welcome to Gotham Comedy Live in beautiful New York City. And here we are live. This is live television on Access TV. Good to be here. I'm glad I'm back in New York. I love New York. I love taking taxis. You know what I don't love? When I get in a taxi, happened to me tonight. You ever get in a cab and the guy driving isn't the guy in the picture? Doesn't that scare the shit out of you? I swear, I'm driving down the street. There's a picture of a Jamaican guy. There's a Korean guy driving the cab. It's going the wrong way on the West Side Highway. I'm like, hey, that doesn't look like you. And he's like, that's me. Same, same. I'm like, okay, Mustafa, little creepy there. You don't know whether to report the guy. It could be a felon. Maybe he stole it. Who knows? This is my first time on the road. I got a two-year-old baby at home. Me and my wife, this is the first time we traveled without the baby. And it is awesome. O-M fucking God. Amazing. I slept until 10:30 today. Do you? No, that's lunchtime in high school. Do you know what 10:30? What? 10:30? Then I took a nap. Then we had sex. My wife and I had sex for 16 seconds in a row. In a row. I didn't even take a break, nothing. And I had an orange Gatorade on the nightstand. I'm looking at it. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to treat myself at the end of this marathon. My poor wife. A lot of comics, they'll come on stage and tell you they have really giant penises and they have sex for like 3 days straight. And I'm not one of them. I have a very small penis, but the good news is I don't take up a lot of your time. 16 seconds in a row. When you have kids, sex the way you used to do it, just throw it out the window. You know, no longer. You're not spanking each other. There's no more fish hooks, donkey punches. You're not pulling hair, spitting in each other's mouths, none of that stuff. Remember the old days, your girlfriend would be on the bottom and she's got you in a chokehold and you're like, holy shit, daddy issues, all right. Gone. That's all out. You can't do any positions when you have kids. You can. You can't do doggy style, cowgirl, reverse, I don't know what they're called. Missionary. You can't do any positions because someone's asshole is facing the door at all times. And you don't want your toddler walking into that Morse code. Leave the room. Leave dot dot dash dot dash dash dot. Leave the room dash dash dot. Leave the room. We were just wrestling. That's what you got to tell your kids. We were wrestling. You know what my son said? How come mommy always loses? Daddy's a wrestler. Wrestled in high school. Mommy's more of a striker, but when it gets to the ground on the mattress, that, you know, I take over from there. Sure. Sure. When you have kids, you can only make love laying on your side. You just lay on your side the whole time, and you just stare at a doorknob for the whole 16 seconds. Hoping it doesn't turn. Just 16 seconds. You're not even paying attention to each other. You're just staring at a doorknob. And your wife goes, I think you're done. You're like, you know what? I've been done. I'm sorry. I wasn't. Just that. You're looking at the doorknob or that crack between the door and the floor. That little 1-inch crack. Hoping you don't see those little Stride Right size 1 shoes. Ugh. The ones that light up, that'll make you lose your erection right there. It better. If it doesn't, you better see a psychiatrist quickly. My wife and I are always playing tricks on one another. Who can get the baby to do the most outlandish thing to freak the other parent out, you know? Like I tried, I taught the baby, you know, put a bean in his nose. I thought that'd be funny, like a little lima bean, put it in his nose. And then it gets stuck, and we got to take him to the doctor with the tweezers, take the bean out of his nose. And my wife goes, what happened? And I go, I don't know, he's a weird kid, he puts beans in his nose. Like, I'm not going to admit that my plan failed, right? My wife is way better at it than I am. She's much smarter than me, she's funnier than me, she writes half my act, this is all true. She had the best joke. Look, I have one fear. A lot of people say, like, hey, never admit your biggest fear. I'll tell you my biggest fear. I'm not afraid of snakes, spiders, heights. I don't give a shit about any of it. British children scare the shit out of me. If you have, like, an 8-year-old kid and I go, how you doing? He goes, I'm doing all right. Ah, I run in the other. It scares the shit. That's not right with their weird teeth. They always got crusty mouths, those short pants and stupid hats. They're all pale white. You can see their veins on their little parchment paper skin. They're always wearing a sweater that's all pilly, and you're They scare the hell out of me. And I don't even like the word phobia. Like, if you're afraid of, like, spiders, arachnophobia, or snakes, snake phobia. I don't know what it's called. But one of them I hate, when people say homophobia. I always hated that one, because a phobia means you're so afraid of something, it's a phobia. Like, if you guys right here, I don't pick on anybody, don't worry. If you guys right here are all afraid of spiders, you have arachnophobia, and I took a bucket of spiders and I threw them on your table, look, they just flinched right then, like, Jesus, you would go, ah, and you'd run out of the goddamn room because there's fucking spiders on your table. But if I said, hi, I'm Jay, this is my friend Billy, he's gay, you guys wouldn't go, ah! It's not a phobia, just call it what it is. Republican, I don't know, make... Come up with another name for it, is all I'm saying. Because you're not afraid of gay people, but if I throw a bucket of gay, just thought of that, bucket, then you might run, new from KFC, bucket of gay. You want regular or extra crispy? What do I look new? Extra crispy, come on. No breasts in the bucket of gay, KFC. Anyway, I'm afraid of British babies, that's my phobia. I can't even watch AC/DC because Angus Young wears those little short pants, and even that's too close. They always look like they're gonna take my soul. It's like the Omen. Hello, not. I had a show in San Francisco. I live in LA. I drive all the way up to San Francisco, and I do the show. I drive all the way back. I get home at 3 a.m. My wife's been up with the baby. Now it's my turn. I'm laying in bed. The baby starts to cry. I get the baby. He's 2 years old. I change his diaper in the over here, and then as I'm walking him back across the nursery, his room, he's sound asleep. Just like this beautiful baby in his little pajamas. Oh, gorgeous. Oh, God. So beautiful. And I'm carrying him. And he's like dead weight. And I'm just carrying him like this. And then he just turns, opens his eyes, and goes, hello, darling. I dropped the baby right there. I dropped my own. It's carpeted. I'm not abusive. It's a carpeted room. I'm not going to drop him on hardwood floors. He could get a little skibidood, you know? I dropped the baby, he dropped his tea. It scared me. But what freaked me out was he faked sleeping. My wife and him worked it out so well that he acted like he was asleep and went, hello, darling. Yuck. Everything I try to do to make the baby funny backfires on me. We're playing Lincoln Logs. This happened last Thursday. Just happened. Me, my wife, and our baby, Mackie, we're on the ground, we're playing Lincoln Logs, and there's a little farm set up, and the farmer keeps tipping over. I can't stand him up. I made a cool barn, and I'm proud. I want the farmer in the barn. I go, all right, you know what? This guy's a dick. And I look at the baby. I go, oh, this will be funny. I'll teach him to curse. So I go, Mackie, look at this. This guy's a dick. Say, that guy's a dick. And the baby goes, that guy. I go, no, that guy's a dick. And he goes, that guy. Now I'm getting, like, aggravated because he doesn't curse. I'm like, no, look at my mouth. That guy's a dick. And the baby again looks at me and goes, that guy. I go, that guy's a dick. He goes, that guy. My wife looks at the baby and goes, honey, don't say that. And the baby looks at my wife and goes, daddy's a dick. Swear to God that happened. Daddy's a dick. My wife looks at the baby and goes, that's right. And then they look at each other, hello, darling. And then I got on a plane and I came here for safety. Gotham, here we are. We are live at Gotham Comedy Club, ladies and gentlemen, on Access TV. We have great comics for you. Don't go anywhere. You're very smart to be watching this. Let's do it.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV. Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Joe List is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Yes. Gotham Comedy Live on Access TV. At home, you are watching a live show right here at the greatest comedy club in Manhattan, Gotham Comedy Club. Now, let's do it. Let's see some great comics. Please welcome a very, very funny guy. I put my name on it from Comedy Central. Huge round of applause. Joe List, come on.
Thanks. Boy, well, thanks everybody. That was exciting, thank you. I'm a little nervous, I get nervous on stage, mostly because I'm self-conscious about my looks. And a lot of you girls are probably like, how come, you're adorable. And I appreciate that. Thank you. I'll see you after the show. I'm mostly self-conscious about my teeth. I was talking to my buddy the other day, I was confiding in him. I was like, man, I'm really self-conscious about my teeth. And they looked at him and he was like, dude, all you need is some Crest whitening strips. I was like, thanks, man. I'm actually self-conscious that they're crooked, but what the hell? Let's throw yellow in there. I'll get that involved. Then a couple weeks after that, I was talking to my nephew. I have a nephew, he's 5. I call him Neff because I can't remember his name. And we were having like a big heart-to-heart. I was giving him some wisdom. In the middle of my big talk, he was like, Uncle Joe, why are your teeth yellow? I was like, I think it's because Santa Claus isn't real. That's probably the main reason. Then we both had a good cry, and I exchanged his Christmas gift for an electric toothbrush that I've been using. I like kids. I read an article online recently that said sometimes if a baby is crying, it could be as little a thing as the baby has an itch, but doesn't have the capacity to scratch it because it's like a dumb, itchy baby. So if you're around a crying baby, just scratch the shit out of that thing. That's what I do. I'm like, I got this one, everybody. My sister's like, why is the baby all red? I'm like, he's probably emotional that somebody finally figured out what was wrong. And she's like, he's bleeding. I'm like, he was crying pretty hard. At first I was like, that's really smart that they figured out a baby could be crying. And then I was like, maybe that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my entire, if I was on the Family Feud, and they were like, we have the top 5 reasons why a baby might be crying. And someone in my family was like, maybe he's itchy. I'd be like, you piece of shit. I don't know why we had you on here. Sometimes when a baby is crying, people feed it, and that gets the baby to stop crying. But that doesn't necessarily mean it wasn't an itch. Because if I had an itch that I couldn't reach, and somebody put their tit in my mouth, I'd be like, forget about that itch. This is the best. Yeah. Oh, thank you, guys. That's nice. I think the lesson is tit trumps itch. I like kids. I think we put way too much emphasis on teaching kids what sounds farm animals make in this country. That seems to be a big part of the curriculum for some reason. Every time I'm near a child, somebody is like, what sound does a chicken make? And he's like, bawk! I'm like, isn't he smart? I'm like, I guess. That has never come up once in my adult life, ever. I've never been on a job interview, period. But I've never heard of someone on a job interview like we see went to college. Could you do your horsey impression real quick? We like to make sure everyone knows their animal noises here at the firm. Even if you wanted to be a farmer, I can't imagine that coming up. Like a farmer's in front of all of his animals. Who the hell said oink? I cannot help you if I don't know who said this. I haven't studied in a while. It's a lot of work having kids. I know it is, because people with kids try to get me directly involved with their kids without asking my permission first. I was at a supermarket the other day. This woman was pushing a baby carriage. The baby was crying. She yelled at it. She goes, "You better stop crying. You're bothering this nice young man right here." And she points at me. And now I'm just involved in disciplining a child that I don't know. I was like, "You're actually not bothering me at all. You're bothering your mother, and she's bothering me. That's what's actually happening." Yeah. Thank you. I'm like, I'm stoned buying fudgicles. I could give a shit that your baby is crying. I don't really care. He probably just needs to be scratched, to be honest with you. I would scratch him up and leave me out of this. But I like having sex. I don't want kids, but I do like having sex. It's a lot of it. It's a lot of fun, right? Oh, thank you. Oh, the same woman from before. Oh, well. You guys are a good crowd. I like having sex. I have a girlfriend I have sex with. Unless any of you are interested in having sex with me in that case. My girlfriend died a couple days ago, and I'm just... You guys are fucking me up by doing that. Jesus. She's not gonna like that. I have sex with my... Recently, my girlfriend and I were up in Vermont. We were up in the woods, in a hotel. We weren't just in the woods. That'd be cold and creepy. We were about to have sex, and we were, like, literally about to have sex. We were both naked. I was wearing a condom. We're very safe. And right before we had sex, like the moment before, she was like, "Wait, I just got creeped out." And that's not a sentence you ever want to hear right before sex. I was like, "Is it my teeth? My nephew said something about this. I'm gonna work on it. I don't know." And she was like, "No, could you check under the bed to make sure that nobody's under there?" And I was like, "Well, you have just come up with the most efficient way to get rid of an erection of all time. I'm now terrified. I've heard of women thinking of other men during sex, but not other men under the bed." I was like, "What am I supposed to do if somebody's under the bed?" And she was like, "Protect me." I was like, "I'm wearing a condom, all right?" So I had to check under the bed. I'm like, "Well, how is that conversation supposed to go if there's somebody in I've never been in a fight in my life. Now I have to bounce a psychopath out of our hotel room. All right, you son of a bitch, we got you. Get the hell out of here, you piece of shit. Like he's just been under my bed for 15 hours. Dah, you got me. All right, I'm sorry. I'll go to the, do you want to hide now and I'll find, no, we're going to have sex. All right, well. That would have been kind of neat if there was a guy under my, that would have been the closest I've ever come to having a threesome if there was a guy under the bed. That's not completely true. The closest I've ever come to having a threesome, this is a little weird. One time when I was a kid, one time when I was a kid, I was masturbating and both of my parents walked in on me. That's probably... That's probably the closest I've ever come. That is not a true story, but it's a great joke. I like having sex. It makes me nervous, though. I have horrible anxiety. You probably can't tell that I have anxiety. I'm playing it pretty cool up here. Got my hand in my pocket. That seems cool. You ever gonna put your foot up on something to look cool and then you realize that it's a much higher surface than you originally realized? I was at a party the other day talking to a girl. I'm like, "Yeah, I do comedy. It's pretty sweet." Well, that looked a lot lower when I started this move. "You can't panic. You gotta go with it." I'm like, "Yeah, I just thought I wanna see my balls through my jeans here." Your knees should never be higher than your genitals in a conversation. That's a good rule of thumb, just generally. I was at a hotel recently. When you have anxiety, everyone has a solution. I was at a hotel. The hotel room had a steam room. I mean, the hotel had a steam room, not my hotel room. I'm not doing that well. The hotel had a steam room. My buddy was like, "You gotta go take a steam. A steam room is really relaxing." A steam room is relaxing if you're the only person in the steam room. That's relaxing. Then you hear that door swing open and you realize that somebody else has entered the steam room, but you can't see them because it's too steamy. That's no longer a relaxing situation. Now you're in some sort of weird ghost porn. Or I'm just sharing a tiny, steamy space with an elderly, naked man that I can't see until he's a penis distance away from my face. I'm like, "Hello? Is somebody in here?" And you can't feel around for him. That's no good. I'm just laying in a puddle of ringworm. All of a sudden, a spirit dick appears in front of my eyes. I'm like, "Ah! You guys are great. Thank you very much. Thank you."
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. DC Benny is taking the stage when we return.
Ladies and gentlemen, one of my oldest friends in comedy. We were in the trenches together way back in the day. You've seen him on Comedy Central. A great friend, an even better comic. Please welcome DC Benny, everybody.
Well, good to be here, everybody. Good to be here. Everybody drinking? You guys drinking? I like to make up drinks, you know, just to mess with the bartender. Be like, what do you want? I'll have a jerk off in the shower. Yeah. What's in that? My hand, my dick, an olive. Put the umbrella, hook it up. I was just in Times Square today. I got into a discussion with the Nubian Israelites. I don't know if you know those guys. They got the turbans and the staffs. Look like the bad guys from He-Man. Apparently somebody white pissed him off a long time ago. The guy's reading from the book, and I started laughing at some of the stuff, but I started learning some shit. I'm like, holy shit, man, the white man did that? That's messed up, because it was like a pie chart. There was a lot of data. You're like, yeah, you know. Like, damn, the white man did that too? That's messed up. But then the guy lost me, looks at me, he's like, you know what the real N-word is? Psh, knowledge. And it's a K-word, everybody. It's a K-word, that's what's funny about that. New York people don't care, right? They don't give to the homeless. Always make excuses why not to give them money. You could be messed up homeless, have no arms, no legs, just be a head on the sidewalk with an eye patch and a speech impediment, little sign saying, please give. Some guy walked by, yeah, but how'd you write that fucking sign? Go, boom. No, honey, I seen these heads all over the place. Go get a hat. They kicked the head. I love it. Times Square getting all Disney-fied now. But I figure it's New York. It'll go back to normal. We'll give it a couple years. Seven Dwarfs will be walking around. Little kids will come up. Where's Snow White? You know, right here, motherfucker. Mickey Mouse will be out on the corner. Suck your dick for some cheese. I live in Brooklyn. I live in Brooklyn. I love it there. You know, it's nice. It was nice. Bomb. We bought a house there, a fixer-upper, which means it's fucked up. You know, there's holes in the floor. You can reach through and change a light bulb on the floor below. My wife hired some contractor to do some work. It was this Russian cat who clearly had done some time. Like, he showed up, he had those teardrop tattoos on his face. You know, whoever drew him in the joint drew him all crooked, so it looked like he was crying in the wind. This guy, Vladimir. His English was pretty good, but he'd take an English word, use it out of context, make me a little concerned, you know. Like the word technically, he loved that word. I'd be like, you know, Vladimir, can you knock out that wall and fix that hole and everything? Yeah, technically, yes, yes, you know. Then he's speaking Russian to these two guys he's with, sounds like English being played back, which means, shnish, shnitzke, pish, shnitz, shnish, shnitzkish. Schnitzke, pish, schnitz, netke, netke, nibbles on your fruity bubbles of your schnitzke, pish, netz, net, 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 schnibbles. His phone goes off, it's got a Russian rap ring telling you, schnish, do the pish, if the nits, get a pish, get the nits. And at the end of the song, this DJ's voice comes on and goes, Russia is the best. I don't know why that's funny, but it's just funny, you know. So the work starts, this dude disappears for like 2 weeks. He leaves these other criminals there. I mean, one guy has a tattoo on his neck of an angel holding a box cutter. I'm like, what the fuck? You know, you will never get a job with that tattoo, you know. There's smoke in the house. My wife doesn't like the smoke, and so I'm like, hey, you know, trying to talk. No smoke in the house. You know, what's that tattoo mean? You know, to kill. Okay, you can smoke in the house, you know. Russia is the best. I love it. So 2 weeks later, the contractor shows up, Vladimir, and wife's like, you got to confront them. I'm like, fuck. So I'm like, dude, you know, where were you?
I have, what is word, date.
I'm like, a date?
Court date. What happened? I go with this girl on date. She talked too much. I punch her face.
I'm like, you punched her face?
Technically, yes. Yes. Schnitzke, nibbles. Nibbles.
So this dude gets fired. He gets fired. Wife hires this other, Kabir from Bangladesh. Kabir. Hey, Kabir. That's his name, bro. I didn't name him. It's a good name, Kabir. It's good. It's Ripak backwards. No, Kabir was great. Kabir, and the work, I gotta recommend this dude. The work was on time. Everything was good. But there was a little cultural issue because he kept pulling me aside. He wanted to add, we had a very small budget. He kept trying to add stuff, like these architectural innovations. You know, he'd be like, please, I'm gonna talk one moment. What's up? He's like, I want to build in the back of the house the one little house. You know, it's good. It's good for the time when your wife's getting crazy, you know. I feel fat and bloated with the cramp. Put in the house and close the door.
Okay. Let me just run that by her, the menstrual shack. She's going to love it. Yeah, that's fine.
I live there in Brooklyn, so. Dude sells real estate. Yeah. I sold real estate, too, in Brooklyn. But a lot of guys I work with, they don't know I do this. I've been doing this a long time. Right, so I have open house. You guys know open house? Yeah. Some stuff's for sale. The dude's got to wait in there and sell it. So I got this thing. You cannot sell this thing, right? This apartment. Nobody. I'm there 2 hours. I'm about to wrap up. The buzzer. The buzzer goes on. About to leave. So I buzz a couple in. Guy and a girl. The girl comes in first. I'm like, hey, I'm Benny. Could you sign in on the sheet? She's like, hey, I'm sorry. You know. I go to the guy. Hey, I'm Benny. Could you sign on the sheet? And he's like, hey, my name's Mike. And, that's the kind of shit I think is really funny, you know, when someone has a messed up stutter, but you can't laugh at it in that context. You got to be all professional. But this guy won't stop talking, right? And the more he talks, the worse the stutter gets. He's like, what's the maintenance? I can't even look at him. Like, dude, it's on the sheet. Just read, it's on it. He's like, when was this renovated? I'm like, fucking recently, And it gets to the point, I don't want to laugh, you know, but I start finishing his sentences just so I don't have to hear him talk. You know, he's like, would it be okay if I use the bubba? I'm like, the bathroom, go right ahead, buddy, you know. So he goes into the bathroom, and the lady's staring at me, and it's really awkward, right? I'm like, you know, is everything okay? And she's like, you know, you look really familiar. I'm like, I don't know, maybe you came to another open house or something. She's like, no, this is the first one we've seen. I'm like, she's like, are you in the teaching profession? I'm like, no. And I'm like, you know, do a little comedy. She's like, that's where I know you from. You made fun of my husband, right? The dude comes out of the bathroom. She's like, that's the guy that made fun of you that night. He looks at me, he's like, motherfucker, right? So now I remember this guy, right? And it was at one of these clubs in the city. It was late at night. The crowd was drunk. It was getting heckled. You know, I'm going. I'm shutting down this table. I'm shutting down this. I just want to do my material. So finally, it's quiet. I'm going into my material. I hear this voice in the back. I'm like, who's making noise now? I hear this voice go, me. So I'm like, me. So I got to do a fucking half hour on this guy, right? And I'm saying horrible stuff. I'm like, you know, he's driving the little yellow bus, like ma. You know, he's blowing somebody with the stutter, like ma. You know? So this is the guy, right? And now I'm stuck in the apartment with him and he's lecturing me. He's like, you shouldn't make fun of people with disabilities. I'm like, dude, you shouldn't come to a comedy club at midnight and heckle if you got a messed up stutter, you know? It's not a good strategy. We're fucking professionals, man. So finally they leave, but because it was me, I couldn't resist. I waited till they're outside. I pushed the buzzer. I was like, bye. And I locked myself in. I waited for an extra half hour. And it was good. I'll do this too. Close with this. This is I don't miss, we got the house now. I don't miss having an apartment, except for one thing is when stuff would break, you call the super of the building. I think supers have superpowers, like the power to disappear anytime there's some shit and they hear you coming quickly in the shape of a Kotrak. You're like, hey, sorry. I remember I called my super once, the toilet broke down. He didn't fix it. He just analyzed it. He's explaining all this technical stuff, you know, whopping. What happened, the pipe having some crack and water going play because the other pipe is way for the water come that way, but he don't go that way because the one bacterial little ball they put to the floor on top, but it's safe.
I think what happened, maybe somebody very strong, maybe why is she coming, she flushing too hard. That's a break, the toilet. But don't worry, I get the paracord to somebody, my cousin, sometimes he there, sometimes he don't there. And that's a very expensive. Take a long time, maybe 30 days, maybe even 1 month. Good night, everybody. Thank you so much.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV. Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, James Davis is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs right now.
Yes, welcome back. Please welcome from the Real Husbands of Hollywood, the very funny James Davis, everybody. Let's hear it.
Woo. All right. Stop clapping if you want. Or just keep on going. Guys, you know what? Make some noise for yourselves. New York, make some noise for yourselves right now. Yes. Yes, you guys deserve it. Now, make some noise for diversity. Make some noise for diversity. thank you. Yes. I am officially like the Jackie Robinson of this show. I'm the first black guy to hit it. You know what I'm saying? Are you guys ready for this? I'm going to make history. It's going to be good. I'm from LA, so that weather out there is the bullshit to me. That is too cold. I knew it was gonna be too cold on the plane. I was in first class, swag, that's just how I fly. and I was asleep, woke up, looked out that window, and I was like, that is not okay. Pilot, pull up, we can't land. That's not okay unless we have hockey skates for landing gear. We can't do this. But I didn't even know how cold was till I walked out the airport and I actually felt it. And I was like, oh, this is unlivable. No. We gotta get out of here right now. Where is FEMA when you need it? They should be airdropping hot chocolate and heaters to you guys. This is unsafe. Where is Barack when you need him? This is not okay. I salute you guys and your jackets. Barack, give it up for him. He just had the State of the Union. Yeah. Thank you on behalf of him, because I'm black, so I'm the closest representative. I said State of a Union, the Union, whatever. At the end of the day, I feel like Barack, his polls are down. He needs to pass that law that makes everybody happy. You know? What? That is number two. That is number two. For the people out there in TV land, somebody in the crowd suggested Barack legalize weed, which I feel like, as a black president, is a little cliche, you know? So, let's not do that yet, you know? Not yet. Baby steps. Baby steps. I feel like first what he needs to do, wait for it, make McDonald's breakfast all day. That needs to be a law immediately, you know? 1 o'clock, breakfast. 2 o'clock, breakfast. Oh, it's afternoon. I want some breakfast, bitch. Like, what's so special about McDonald's breakfast that it has to end at 10:30? Like, do they have some magical, mystical biscuits and eggs that just disintegrate at the stroke of 10:29:59? Can I get some breakfast? It turned to sand, silly. Don't you read the back of your fry box that says right under the grease, turns to sand. You gotta read the greasy fine print. Have you ever showed up at like 10:27 and still been denied? Don't you feel like Rosa Parks and they told you to sit in the back? Whoa, my rights. It's 10:27, that's 3 more minutes. That's 180 seconds of eggs I deserve. Martin, Malcolm, it's time to march. They're tripping over here at this McDonald's. Either that or I go straight crackhead. Oh, don't do me like that. No. Listen, open up the window. open up the window. Listen, I have my own eggs and bacon. I just need the McGriddle biscuit, baby. I'll suck your biscuit, please. Don't do me. Ba da 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 da. And sing, because I don't do crack. I don't do crack. I don't even know how they live. Thank you. Thank you. Now, are you guys clapping for the joke or my abstinence from crack? I don't know, but I will accept it either way. I just want to show up there at like 10:45, and they say, no breakfast. I'm like, oh, that's, oh, that, oh, really? Guess who's in the back seat? Barack, holla at him. He's like, he wakes up from a nap. Now listen. I understand that breakfast ends at 10:30. But that's one of the failed policies of the last 10 years. Me and my wife, Michelle, our daughter, Sasha Malia, we're hungry. Thank you. Side note, I love how he says Michelle, Sasha, Malia. Never Malia, Michelle, Sasha. Or Sasha, Michelle, Malia. Always Michelle, Sasha, Malia. In that order. Like there's some kind of singing group. And it has to be said like that. Like every time he shouts out his family, I just hear, I like to recognize my family, Earth, Wind, and Fire. My daughters, Frankie, Beverly, and Maze. My nephews, Ronnie, Bobby, Ricky, and Mike. thank you. Thank you. Now, Gotham, listen, Gotham, there's an old lady who works in Idaho. And maybe she can't get her sausage, egg, and muffin. Her bacon, egg, and cheese biscuit. But I charge you the next time she comes. And she asks, can you serve me breakfast? I want you to tell her, as I told you, yes, we can. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I love how Barack says thank you. Thank you. Like he says 50 thank yous per speech. She's like, find somebody in the back. You right there. Thank you. It makes me think like when Michelle's like kissing on him, he's like, oh, thank you. She starts making her way down. Oh, you don't have, thank you. Change. I feel like I'm gonna be sent to prison after that joke. I like it. I like you guys are out here. It feels like the club, but not, you know? And by the way, in 2014, I'm retired from the club. I can't do it anymore. I like bars and house parties, you know? Here's the thing about the club. I never have the fun I envision myself having while getting ready for the club. Like when I'm getting ready for the club, I picture a music video. I'm coming through slow motion, women all around me, high fives. It looks like a music video, but me. But here's the thing. If you're not popping bottles and buying tables, you ain't nothing but a background extra in someone else's music video. You are atmosphere in the club. The only reason you're there is so that the people at VIP have someone to look at. There can't be regular P if there's not VIP. And we're there in regular P, crowded, you got man booty bumping up on you like, yo, dude, turn down, all right? You're in my area, I respect what you guys are doing, but your butt touched my hip and that's accidentally gay, okay? Don't let it happen again. You ever try to talk to a waitress as she walks through VIP? Like, or walks through regular P to get to VIP? Excuse me, can I get a drink? Ah, get off me! The porridge is over there, like porridge? They serve porridge here? And fellas, don't do this. Do not do this. Don't go to the club with your homeboys. Try to put your money together and try to pop a bottle. The phrase is popping bottles. Multiple bottles. You ain't never heard a rapper. We in the club popping bottle. We in the club with one bottle. No, it's too much pressure. Because once that bottle runs out, they will usher you back to where? Regular pee. So now you have to protect that bottle like a baby in the club. You might have to check your best friend, Contrail. That's a lot of gulps, my nigga. What did we talk about in the car? Sip, song, song, sip. Song, song, sip. Why are you deviating the game plan? I'm James Davis, thank you very much.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Harry Stanton is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Ladies and gentlemen of Gotham Comedy Club, we're here at Gotham Comedy Live on Access TV. Let's see another great comic. Ladies and gentlemen from Comics Unleashed, please welcome Harris Stanton.
What's up? All right. Calm down, I only got 9 minutes. 2014, man, y'all ready? I hope it's better than my 13. My 13 ended horrifically, sir, with a colonoscopy. You ever had a colonoscopy? You'll get one. Some people don't even know what it is. I find that weird. It's when they take a camera and stick it up your butt and have a Kodak moment deep inside your asshole. It's a little scary, man. I told the doctor I was nervous. I said, look, doc, I'm a little nervous. I never had this procedure done before. He's like, don't worry about it. We're gonna put you to sleep. You're not gonna feel a thing. I'm like, you didn't have to tell me that. I know you're gonna do that, because that's the only way you're gonna go rummaging around in my asshole without being knocked unconscious during the process. I'm sure somebody had one before. The prep work is brutal. Shit you gotta do before, you gotta drink like a gallon of a laxative, and you can't eat anything like Jell-O and water, and I'm telling you, a milk jug of a laxative. I almost didn't get through it. It was horrible, man, which made me think that somebody on the planet didn't get through this shit. They went, you know what, I can't finish it. I'm just not gonna finish it. I'm gonna go to the hospital. Maybe they won't notice. Doctors put him to sleep, woke his ass up. Get up, get up. Did you not think we wouldn't notice this giant piece of shit in your ass, sir? Did you drink any of the gallon of stuff we gave you? Are you insane? Did you eat an elephant before you came here? We can't get the camera past this mammoth turd. Fuck off my table, sir, and go take a dump. I don't care how sexy and cool you are. You go to the hospital, doctors erase that shit immediately. You just sick. Went to the hospital, it was like, take all your clothes off, take that stupid hat off, take your underwear off, and put on these two cooking aprons. That's basically what they wore, like one in the front, one in the back, and your dick and balls are just swinging around. It's uncomfortable. But don't be too uncomfortable. There's like three or four other guys with their balls out, so it's like a little party. Minus the cold cut sandwiches in the middle of the room for everybody to eat with their balls out. This is delicious. What kind of meat is this? I don't know. She said, once you finish that, you can go over there and sit in that cubby hole and we'll take your blood pressure and give you a water IV. But as she was telling me this, there was this old dude getting up from getting his blood pressure taken with his balls and asshole out. I'm like, lady, you want me to sit in that same chair that he was sitting in? Y'all don't got another chair? Everybody's hygiene is different. How many open assholes been in that chair? Since before I got here, it's 5 o'clock now. What time y'all start these procedures? 47 assholes in that chair. You want me to sit in that shit? I don't got no rip-away paper or nothing, same chair. She got upset. She's like, can we get another chair? Apparently this guy's asshole is special. It's not sanitary, it's not special, it's just, you know. I'm all right though, everything came out all right. I thought I was dying, you know. I'm a glass half empty guy, you know. I think I'm dying. I smoke cigarettes and I'm trying to quit, otherwise I'm gonna get cancer, right? Anybody quit smoking cigarettes in here, by the way? You quit? How long did you smoke before you quit? Couple. Oh, you could smoke some more and shit. I want to quit, man. I don't know how cold turkey doesn't work. I want to try Chantix. I saw the commercials, but when I Googled it, Chantix was worse than fucking cigarettes. You ever see the side effects of Chantix? Hostility, vomiting, suicidal thoughts. Suicidal thoughts? I think I'm gonna die of cancer in several years. I'm gonna jump off of a damn roof in 2 weeks on Chantix. I could be on the ground, smoking. Can you imagine? Yo, don't jump, you got your whole life ahead of you. Come on down and have a smoke, you live longer. You still gonna die, but just not now. These cigarette commercials annoy me, man. You ever see these graphic cigarette commercials? They try to help you quit, but they try to scare you into quitting. They show you these deformed people. This one guy, he got a hole in his neck, and he can't swim for some reason. And he's cleaning it with a swab. I could never swim again. I'm like, oh, that's fucked up, sir. That's what happens? I thought it was just cancer. Swimming too? Shit. And you try to rationalize, I ain't been in the pool in 7 years. And the lady comes on, she had her fingers amputated. Like, oh my God, I need my fingers to smoke. Shit. I saw this TV commercial about cigarette quitting smoking, and it was these guys testifying about how they quit smoking, right? And this one guy was like, I quit smoking because a doctor told me how bad my health was getting. I was like, all right, that makes sense. Second guy was like, I quit smoking because I want to see my kids grow up. I'm like, okay, that makes more sense. Third guy was weird. He was like, exercise. I'm like, really? He was like, yeah, instead of smoking cigarettes, I just exercise. I'm like, really, asshole? Maybe you shouldn't be in this fucking commercial because your cure is dumb. Exercise, really? Listen, quitting smoking is one of the hardest things you ever do in your life, okay? And for some people, so is exercise. So you can't cure something that's hard to quit but something that's even more challenging to do. Doesn't make any sense. I used to be an alcoholic, but now instead of drinking a bottle of Jack, I study quantum physics and it helps out a lot. Same shit. Bad habits are terrible, man. I picked up a lot of bad habits when I moved to New York. My mom didn't want me to move to New York because of bad habits. Like, you're going to pick up bad habits and you're going to get stabbed and raped. I'm like, what? I'm going to New York, not prison. Relax. I might pick up some bad habits. I might even get stabbed. But I seriously doubt somebody's going to fuck me up their ass against my will. I got a pretty strong will. She's pretty overprotective, man, and she's very religious too, man. Annoyingly religious. She be trying to get me on the same page. She's like, you don't go to church on Sunday? I'm like, no. You should go to church every Sunday and Tuesdays and Thursdays. I'm like, ugh. I don't have the heart to tell her I think it's silly. Like, I believe in a higher power, but I just think religion is retarded. I mean, every religion thinks they're right, right? This is why religion is silly. I was in Crown Heights, Brooklyn recently, right? And that's a big Jewish neighborhood, right? And I was buying some weed, but that's not important. And I'm walking to the subway with my delicious bag of weed, and this Jewish dude is standing out in front of his house, freezing to death. He's like, excuse me, sir, could you come to my house and help me turn my heat on? What? And I heard what he said, but I was like, excuse me? He's like, could you come to my house and help me turn my heat on? I was like, nah, motherfucker, this is like a setup. I'm not gonna come in your house and help you turn your heat on. You hit me in the back of the head with a wrench, steal my weed. I'll be the first black guy to die in the Crown Heights murders. My self-preservation kicked in. You know, I watched too much of the ID channel. I walked off, I couldn't help him, man. But I was really concerned about this guy, and I found out, because I Googled some shit, I found out Orthodox Jews can't touch electricity during the Sabbath. Why? It's considered work. It's not work, it's a hand gesture. I thank God to forgive you for not freezing to death. It's gonna look, God, the big black man won't come to my house and turn my heat on. You understand, right? This ain't work. I can do this shit all day. That way, you turn your heat on, that way you don't have to ask giant black man to come in your house at 1 in the morning and turn your fucking heat on. So what you supposed to do? Just walk around in the dark, run into a wall, break your nose? Now you're bleeding all over the place, and if you live in an apartment building, you can't take the elevator because that's fucking electricity. So now you're running down the steps, bleeding all over the place, wishing you was Muslim or Catholic or whatever religion allows you to take the elevator. Can you imagine getting to heaven and you're in the pearly gates, you're like, hey God, I did everything I was supposed to do. I'm ready to come in to your kingdom. He's like, wait a minute, hold up, let me look at the book of life. And he opens up, okay, you're a pretty good guy. You helped a couple of ladies across the street. You gave to a lot of charities, pretty good. Uh-oh. Says here in 2002, you turned the lights on when you wasn't supposed to. Hey, look, I gotta go, man. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City.
It's Gotham Live. All the comics, round of applause for everybody you saw tonight. Mick Foley is guest hosting next week for Joe List, for DC Benny, for James Davis, for Harris Stanton.